I'm not going to enter into the political battle. If I did, I probably could have a million subscribers, have a radio show, television show, if I got into it, really committed to it. Because I would say stuff that other people would be too frightened or intimidated to say. No holds barred, but that's not going to happen. Why? Because I have something immeasurably more important to talk about, to discuss, to look at. Immeasurably more important. That's why. That's why. It's no slam against anybody who is in the, the political foray. And it's no slam against anyone. It just happens to be the facts that my life has unfolded in such a way as I've been able to see an issue which is transcendently important. And so that's what I'm talking about here. And on these videos, you're getting that high culture, really. The true high culture. Not a drug culture, the real high culture. Okay. So what is this issue that is transcendently important? It is coming to light more and more. Last night I got almost no sleep at all. I was woken up like at 1:30 in the morning. Couldn't sleep. It's just horrible because these issues are surfacing. And they're surfacing in a very powerful way. And there is a way to discuss, to talk about them as we have in other videos. But again, I know there's all this political, social, all this turmoil in the world, for sure. But again, there is this incredibly important issue that the world is overlooking, entirely overlooking. And it is something we can look at, because I'm doing it. I'm absolutely doing it. Will I succeed? Sure, of course. So I'll keep looking at this. What I saw, what I know to be true, is that all suffering is only the result of a mental spell, a spell that we're under. It is very simple, very flimsy. It's we're under a magical spell of definition in our minds, okay, our minds, not the body. The body is just feeling. What we're feeling is really the mind. The mind is the one that does this, experiences and does the feeling. It's the mind that is producing the suffering, actually. And it's all because of a very simple magical spell having to do with definitions and twisting. It's a double twist, as it were, that produces what? If you take a circle and twist it, like take one end, just like a windshield sunblock, and twist it, you get a center point, don't you? And then if you twist it again and again and again, it's all these twistings, but it's all based on just a simple twist of definition. What is that definition? It has to do with time, and it has to do with age, and it has to do with the feeling of aging. It has to do with a feeling of having an age, that we base our identity on age, aging. How old are you? What's your name? Oh, and then how old is that name? How long has that name been in use? Oh, I'm 8 years old. I'm 20 years old. I've been aging for 20 years or something. Very interesting dream last night. I was going in and out. Occasionally I had little fleeting minutes of sleep and the dream would pop up. It's all boiling. The pot is boiling right now, which is a good thing, really, if I can survive it, which I will. And there was this grapevine and I was cutting it and trimming it. And there was somebody there who owned the grapevine that decided to plant it, and it was their grapevine. And I said to them, hey, what do you think about... Actually, he said to me, you know what, I'm thinking of, trimming this vine. And I said, well, I've already done it. And he looked at it, and I'd already make all these cuts, and it was trimmed down to just the rootstock almost. And he said, you know what, why don't we just pull it? Let's just pull the vine, pull the grapevine. I said, okay. pull it out. What does that mean? Well, what are grapes in this area, most areas of the world? They're grown for wine. It was wine, grapes for wine. vine for wine. And what is wine? It's something that's aged. It gets value through aging. Okay. So what was being pulled out, we decided to pull it out, was the whole notion of value through aging. That aging can give you some sort of value, okay, that you really want. And we, you know, we decided, the decision within was pull it out. Pull it out. No more waiting. We were waiting for the grapes, waiting for the wine, waiting, waiting, waiting. And then, interestingly, in the dream, the suicide girl showed up. There's this harlot that showed up, and she's trying to get you engaged with her and to bring suicidal thoughts, actually. Because the idea is, well, without any sense of age, you know, oh, you know, we've got to die where we have no value. So I asked my friend, I said, hey, are you interested in the suicide girl? And he says, well, I'm thinking. I said, no, we got to do some work here. The seductress, the siren, is trying to put suicide thoughts in you. When you are ready to relinquish age, okay, relinquish age, then there's this issue of like, hey, am I going to be valueless? Because we equate age with value, whether it's old age or young age, right? These days, to be young has value, whereas in the past, to be older has value. So as we're going along in age for myself, we're thinking, hey, when we get older, we'll accrue value in this world. But it's completely changed now, whereas the older you get, the less value you have in this world now, and it's only being young. So it's like, wow, I didn't have any value when I was young, because they said, no, you have to wait till you're older. And now that I'm older, they say I have no value either, because you need to be young. It's the double cross that's happened in this world. So I've never felt any value based on my age in this world. So why not drop age altogether? Why not drop the feeling of age? Is it possible? Absolutely, it's possible. No question. In fact, I saw this magic trick that causes the mind to feel age. Age is actually a feeling. It's a spell, a magical spell that we presume. And it's very flimsy. And I saw it this morning. I said, ah, piece of cake. It's easy to see that. It's just a trick. And we don't have to actually feel any sense of age at all. And that means we don't feel young, we don't feel old, we don't feel middle-aged, we don't feel any sense of age whatsoever. No sense of age at all. You could say ageless, but it's even beyond that. There's just no sense of having any age. But the world will say, oh, you don't have any identity then, right? Or you don't have any value, you don't have an identity. So we avoid it. But I can tell you for sure, The mental confusion, is a little trick we use, is simple to see. It's very simple. It's just that we are afraid to see it because we're afraid we'll lose our age. Now, it's just a little twist, as it were, a double twist. And you might even call it a DNA helix. You know, it's a twisting, spiraling, continual spiraling and twisting. Results in form, results in body, results in aging, actually. Now, when we give up a sense of age, a feeling of having any age at all, does that mean the body dies? No. Now, this is very important. I worked on it this morning for many hours. And imagine something like you have you're twisting a rope, at two ends, and you start twisting them in opposite directions, and twist, and it gets tighter and tighter and tighter and tighter. Now, imagine if you just kind of relaxed the twisting a little bit. Not all of it, but just relax the effort to twist. And release some of the tension, as it were. You'd feel very relaxed, right? Now, if age is just this kind of certain kind of mental tension, actually, if you just relax that tension, don't get rid of the rope. Okay, just relax the twisting of the rope. Don't get rid of the rope. Then you will feel ageless, actually. You don't have to get rid of the body, absolutely not. The body is not producing the feeling of age. It is not. It's absolutely not. This is what I saw. It's all in the mind. the body will continue to go through its cycle. It can, of the hair getting gray and white and getting older and all this stuff. But you, the mind, won't feel any sense of age whatsoever, none. Won't feel young, won't feel old, won't feel middle-aged, won't feel any sense of age at all. Something transcendent of that entirely. And it doesn't matter what the body, you know, if someone thinks, well, the body's old, you must feel this way. No, there's no feeling of age at all. Easy to do, as a matter of fact. It's our equation of age with value which is the problem. Because this is, it's deep-seated. And we have this terrible block towards releasing the tension while we're living here, because they, oh my gosh, I've spent all this time aging and I'm trying to gain value, and then I'm going to lose all that value. Value in the eyes of what? In the eyes of time. Time values aging because it's a witness to itself. Anyway, this is the basics of the situation. And there is no question in my mind that this is doable, no question. It's only a matter of relaxing the trick, in the mental trick. It's a mental trick of definition that we're doing in order to try and gain value. Now, why are we trying to gain value through time? That's the question, right? You hear about these spiritual masters, the ascended masters, and all this kind of stuff, and they say, yes, the ascended master has gone through many, many lifetimes, and they've gained all this wisdom and learning, and they've discovered, and you know, it's all time-based, though. It's all time-based, isn't it? And so you think, wow, I mean, I got to go up the spiritual corporate hierarchy and climb that ladder, so I need to get a lot of value. I got to put in, you know, I lived 90 years there and you know, 85 here, and I learned the lessons of, you know, all this stuff, and that we think that that's it. That's got nothing to do with it whatsoever. Time itself is just a mental trick. It's a mental trick. It's not there. It's really, we're just tricking ourselves. It's just a stupid spell we're casting on ourselves, actually. And of course, we have marketers marketing it to us. And that's what I saw. The one who's holding the rope of time is this goddess-like figure that is a super marketer, you know, super seductive marketer, trying to say, hey, you know, she basically says, hey, if you want to interact with me, you got to have some age, you know. I can't hit on you if you have no age. And I said, good, I don't want to have any age then. It's really time that hits on us, isn't it? And tells us, you're going to have, when you get older, you know, you're going to have all these great perks, you know, of aging, a lot of great perks of aging. And then finally they say, you know, the greatest perk of aging is you're going to die. What they don't say is that you will continue on being born again and going through the whole situation over and over until you finally decide to temporarily let go of time. And it is temporary, meaning the body's still there, right? And it's a very key word, temporarily let go of the rope of time, as it were, or the twisting of time, the mental trick of time. It's a mental trick. I've seen it quite a few times, but this time it was simpler, it was more obvious, it was more transparent, it was closer to the surface. And I said, what do I do now? You know, and it's just, look at it in context is what you have to do. I mean, you a lot of people have seen this and had a moment of like, oh my gosh, I'm not really trapped at all. I'm not really trapped at all. It's only a mental trick. And then, you know, the world supersedes and it's gone, lost, and they don't know, what happened? I thought I was free and I'm not now. Whoa, you know, how do I earn my freedom? What's going on? Right back in the same old trap. So, here in this case, it's not like that anymore, having worked on this for a long, 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 long time, actually. There's a little more wisdom here that can be a benefit. we don't struggle with what's the magical trick, because it's so simple. Anybody can look and just laugh at it. Say, oh, that's silly. It's completely silly. It's actually completely silly, actually, what we're doing. But it's the valuing of it that's the problem. So that's what we have to work on. Jesus' advice in A Course in Miracles and what he's given out recently is examine your valuing of the world, including, most importantly, the value of time. The valuing of time. What is time? Aging. If there was no aging, how could there be time? You know, this tree has been here how long? You know, oh, the tree's been here, you know, 150 years, 500-year-old oak, valley oak tree. And wow, you know, it's longevity, Greg, builds up. You think you're going to build, you're building something up. You're building a resume, a spiritual resume. One day you'll be a spiritual master because you built up this resume. And that keeps us valuing time, the feeling of time. Time is just a feeling. And the feeling is just in the mind, actually. And the feeling is just the result of the stupid flim-flam shell game magic trick, which is childishly stupid, you know. Simple. We only fall for it under the spell of the goddess of time, the great marketer of time to us. The siren seductress who says, hey, if you want to run with me, you've got to build up some time, you know. You're not old enough yet for me. It's like the older woman to a boy saying, hey, you got to grow up before you can run with me, you know. So the boy says, oh boy, how can I grow up? How can I grow up? that's how it's marketed. It's marketed to us like we need to grow up, get more time, accrue more time before we get the benefits of this universe. There are no benefits of this universe. It's a scam, actually. It is a scam. It is a training program to teach us how to die. Eventually trying to teach us how to die. As if time, you can build up enough time where you somehow overcome endlessness. So, it is, one has to overcome the valuing of it. So that's the hard work. That's the hard work. Anybody can get a glimpse. All right, we can all get a glimpse of this. But the hard work is to examine your valuing of the world. Now, yesterday I happened to be, was invited to a party, and it was in one of the most unique homes, incredible homes, luxurious, incredible places that you're ever going to be in your life, for sure. And I got absolutely nothing out of it. I felt absolutely nothing. And I realized, oh my gosh, you couldn't have a better place, better people, better party, better say. I was just like incredible, but I felt nothing whatsoever. And I realized that there is no house or no place on this planet where I'm going to feel anything now, really. It's not going to make me happy, for sure. It's not. It's absolutely not. It's like, wow, that's a wake-up call. It's shocking. Put me in the grandest palace in the world and I won't even feel anything. That's a fact. Put me among the most scintillating cognoscenti of the world. I'm not going to feel anything. No, not. Best food. I'm not going to feel anything. Whatever's taking place, the greatest party in the planet, I would feel, in the greatest place, I would feel nothing. I wouldn't feel anything. And wow. He said, well, what do I do? You see, wow, this. Imagine if you're in that position. You're saying, this world can't make me happy. That's the realization. I realized this world cannot make me happy. Never will. So that's why when Suicide Girl tries to get your attention, because she knows the way to lead you down the road to suicide, most definitely. And she's led many down that path, actually. I said, no. Let's back off of that. Back off of that. I know I'm tired, I know I'm exhausted, nothing can make me happy, you know. People would say, well, you're depressed. Well, it's not quite depression. It's teetering, you know, on the edge of depression, but it's also teetering on the edge of freedom from depression. And so right on that scale is, you know, a pivot point. Now, if this happened and you realize the world can't make you happy, of course you would be suicidal, no question about it. So I don't advise people to try and force the issue. You have to go about it by examining your valuing of the world, which is what I've done, which is why it's taken me a long time. I don't think you can force the issue. Because really, again, the issue is completely simple. It's not difficult at all just to see the little stupid definitional trick we're playing on our minds are playing on itself. So that is not the issue. The issue is, do we value aging? Do we value aging? Do we value... If you didn't value aging, you wouldn't need to take a birth, would you? You wouldn't need a body, would you? You wouldn't need to. It's the end of birth and death when you give up value of aging. You say, I don't need something to identify with something that ages. Not at all. And the analogy is used of a ceiling fan. When you turn it off, it's been spinning fast, and then it, you know, slowly slows down. So the easing of this twisting, this easing of this feeling of age, you know, will probably gradually just dissipate. That's what I've seen is going to happen in my life. Just a sense of any aging at all. It's like all the time we have spent trying to age has been a waste of time. All the lives we've spent in existence have been just a waste of time. Nothing more than that. So the great realization and the practice thing, I've completely wasted my life. My entire life has been nothing but a waste of time. My entire life has been nothing but a waste of time. Time is a waste of time. Time is just a cheap trick designed to try and teach me how to die. And it's just a waste. It doesn't do anything. I don't need any sense of age at all. So the parameters are being painted here pretty clearly. Is the difference between those who see value in age, getting some age, whether it's young, youth, whatever, old age, whatever, middle age, who just see value in being associated with a sense of age, and then the others who see no value in that whatsoever. Is the difference between the wheat and the chaff, the wheat and the tares, the sheep and the goats. That's the difference. And how do you overcome valuing of this is the question. It's not easy. It's so ingrained in us. Now, I never liked the idea. People say, look at this redwood tree. It's 2,000 years old. You know, I once visited the bristle cone pine trees in the eastern Sierras, and I walked way up to the top where the oldest, I think it was the oldest tree in the world was. And looked at it, and the whole area there, and it was so desolate. It was so much reeked of death there. You know, they had these fractured, crumbling old trees that have been there for 4,000, 5,000 years, and there's a little part of it still growing. And I just said, what the heck? You know, this is valuable? What's valuable about this? It's nuts. Really? I actually hiked up the mountain, I did it. I just wanted to do that and see. Wow, no. I thought I was going to feel awe, Of course, here we live near the big, huge redwoods, and then the sequoias in California. You go see the sequoias, you see the big redwoods. It's super ancient trees, gigantic trees. And you stand next to them and you think, oh, I'm going to, be in awe of this. And then there's another tree nearby that's fallen, and it's hollowed out. Its inner part is hollowed out. The bark's still there. And you can literally walk through it, walk through the center of the tree. It's all hollowed out for a long ways. And you say, what exactly is the value of this, really? And I don't feel it. I'm not feeling it. So I've never felt the value of age. And so I've always thought something's wrong with me. How come I don't value age? I don't feel any value in it. And there's probably a lot of people like that in the world who, all their lives, they said, I don't feel comfortable here. I don't feel comfortable with what people are telling me. You know, I don't really want to. See, I never wanted to grow up, but what it meant was I never wanted to go along with this idea of feeling age. Never. No, 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 no. I was more like Peter Pan. You know, never grow up, but not to remain young, but just to have no sense feeling of age at all. And so people like that, you know, feel like they're excluded from the world, like they're discriminated against here, most definitely. When you talk about discrimination, that's the big one here. That's really worth talking about. The discrimination against those who want to drop any sense or feeling of age is intense on this planet. We feel like that, you know, we're outcasts here. Really, I felt my whole life like a total outcast here in this place. Because everybody here is like fanatically into age. One of the signs, for instance, and not to pin anyone down or go after anyone. That's not the point of this at all. It's to look. This is inquiries, looking. One of the sure signs of someone who's really into aging, age, the ego, is the Antichrist. It's time. It's trying to learn how to die. All of this is interest in wine, for instance. Interest in wine. People are becoming fanatically interested in wine. I live in the Bay Area of California, and you know, this is a world mecca for wine, and people here are just crazy about it. Wherever you go, any function, there's all sorts of wine, and people are just so totally into it. And even more to the point, the communist Chinese now are going absolutely crazy about wine. There's a movie out called Red Obsession, and they're buying up all the vineyards in Burgundy, Bordeaux, the chateaus, the vineyards, the wine. They're clearing out all the wine from all the restaurants, buying it all up, and they say that there's not enough wine in the whole world for the communist Chinese. They're going crazy for wine. Some lady at the auction paid over $1 million for just one bottle of wine. And that is a sure sign of a mind which is obsessed, which is with age, with the value of aging. Because what is the value in wine, but a symbol for the value of aging? Okay. Now, for me, what do I drink? Water. Water. See, no value in aging whatsoever. None. For me, it's always been just give me some water. I have zero interest in wine. Not, the meter doesn't even go to 0.5, it's just zero. And yet I'm surrounded by vineyards and winemakers, and, you know, it's just like, and nothing. So that's pretty indicative right there, very indicative. And we're made to feel like there's something wrong with us, like, how come you're not interested? And also, I'm vegetarian, and that's also maybe, I mean, I go out and pick an orange off of the tree. The orange is, you know, it's a couple months to form or whatever. Whereas, like, is a beef, you know, the cow has lived, you know, for maybe, I don't know how long, 8 years or 10 years, whatever. The idea is, when you're eating meat, you're eating something that's aged, that's taken a while to form. Whereas I'm more into just the stuff that food that is produced in a quick cycle, you know, just grains, nuts, seasonal crops, tomatoes, you know, just whatever is milk, you know, it comes fresh every day. We used to get milk delivered fresh every day, and just stuff that is fresh. It doesn't take very little time to produce it, and it's just, I naturally gravitate to that. You know, an egg. I'm not a vegan, no, but I mean, the egg is fresh every day. The chicken lays an egg, you take it, breakfast, and it's so those are interesting delineations. The people who are just obsessed with, you know, the port, and you know, it's old age, 180 years, 60 years, whatever, it better and better and better and better with age. Everything gets better and better with age. I'd be happy just to breathe the air, you know, just live off of the air, immediacy of that. So, not that that's important, but it's just an interesting indicator of how much valuing of time, of aging, there is. Not that anyone needs to stop their habits, that's not the point. Because again, there's a way to relax the whole situation so you don't feel any time, no matter what situation. Srinivasagadatta Guru, I think he was still selling beedis. You know, he had a little beedi stall and selling various little things, maybe a little market with cigarettes. I think he kept selling cigarettes even after he had relaxed this aging thing. You know, the habits can still be there. You know, if you drink wine, you don't have to stop drinking wine. You don't have to change your life. What changes, the only change in your life is that you have no sense of having any age at all. There's no feeling of age at all. Like Ramana Maharshi, he got throat cancer and he said, I don't feel any different at all. I don't have any sense of mortality or age or anything like that. That's what they tell us, those who... Sri Anandamayi Ma said she never had any sense of age at all in her entire life. She said that what she is never associated itself with the body consciousness, ever. So I had no sense of age at all, none. Never did. So whatever happened to the body getting old and stuff, didn't affect how it didn't give her a sense of age at all, not in the slightest bit. I think that Srinivasagadatta Guru also had throat cancer or something like that, and said doesn't bother me in the slightest bit. Not suffering at all. Literally, suffering comes to an end when we give up this little mental trick, because we don't feel a sense of age at all. We feel ageless. So where's the suffering? There's no suffering. There's no suffering. There's no pain. There's no suffering. There's no change in that. There's no sense of something changing, time working on something, anything like that. What we realize is the body is not what we are at all. But we don't need to get rid of the body to realize that. Once we realize that the body is just this twisting trick, this trick of twisting DNA, genetic strands, it's just a trick of twisting. It's just a mental trick repeated over and over and over and over and over again ad infinitum. We realize the body is not us at all. It's just a device that's trying to teach us how to die. But it has nothing to do with what we are. Not at all. It's just a rope, like a rope that that's been twisting it. And it's all in our mind, the suffering. It's all in our mind. When we drop it from our mind, it's gone. Doesn't matter. The body doesn't matter at that point. Not at all. And so all of this is being seen here. And it's causing a lot of stress, of course, as you might expect. Maybe just severe sleep deprivation. Because I am pushing things. That party last night was quite interesting. I was just thinking of not even going because I knew I wouldn't do anything for me and I might get depressed, and I decided to go anyway. And I said, you know what? If you're not going to feel something here, you're not going to feel something anywhere. Pretty much so, right? It's like, wow. And it didn't get depressed, but it did bring up this situation. What's the use? You know, what's the use of time, of aging? What's the value? There's no value in it. It's not going to result in anything. So it's all bubbling to the surface now, bubbling the surface. This is more valuable than the political battles and whatever's going on, the mudslinging and all this kind of stuff. That's entertaining, like a football game or something, but it doesn't even touch upon, it does not even begin to touch upon what we literally can touch upon, which is to notice everything that I've said on this video, to notice it, to look at it and see, hey, I can see it, I can look at it. I'm not stuck as I think I am. And I can be temporarily free of all symptoms of temporality. And I say temporary because all perception is temporary. So don't make the mistake of trying to say that you're seeing reality. You're not. The body's still there. Everything's still here. You're still perceiving everything. It's just the sense of age gone. Gone. Gone with the wind. You can say dwelling in the eternal now and this and this and that, but those descriptions are just descriptions. What's important is the context of it. There's too much academicness in spiritual teaching in the world. Too much. Where people go, you know, academic people go to a teacher and they are taking notes. Like, it's like they're trying to prepare a book or something. And going, okay, so, you know, centerless center, or all self without a center, dwell in the eternal now. And they get these buzzwords for it. And the same thing they've done with all their schooling is, how do I get an A in this class? Right? How do I get an A? Okay, here's the teacher, I'm a student, and what does that teacher want me to regurgitate on the test? And so I'm showing the teacher, I'm paying attention, I'm writing stuff down, I'm taking notes, and then they say, okay, when's the test, teacher? And it's just, you know, I'm gearing up for the test. There is no test. There is no test. There's no teacher giving a test. You have to literally see it for yourself. And then relax it. Relax this trick, you know, see it's a trick. And relax, the mind just relaxes from it, and no more need for any feeling of age. So, the buzzwords, like, hey, we need to live in the now, or something. Every time I do that, I feel like it's a trap. It's a trap. Because it's really an organic type, the path is an organic type of thing where you can't just apply some plastic fast food buzzword stuff to it and succeed. It is something that you literally yourself have to make these decisions that are absolutely crucial, like in the dream last night, the decision to pull up that grapevine, pull it up by the roots. It's interesting, I had this summer garden this year, and some of the plants were still going, the pepper plants were still going. They can go all the way to December. And in the past, I let them go. Last year, I let them go. Let's see how long they can go, just for the fun of it. Let's see how long they can go. In other words, how great amount of age can they get? And one plant went the longest of all of them. I said, hey, you're the winner. You still have peppers on, and the rest of them are all dead, so you're the winner. And this time, I said, look, there's no more fruit being produced. Even though there's flowers, it's not going to set. And even if it did set, they're not going to grow. They're going to be stunted. They're going to be small. It's not worth it. I said, look, it's time to pull the plants. Let's pull them. I pulled them, harvested all the peppers. They're drying now. And planted a winter garden. It was that's very unusual for me. It's the first time I've done something like that. In the past, I'd always wanted to see how long, like a tomato plant, how long can it go? The early girls, because they can keep setting fruit all the way into. I've had early girls picked into January, actually. But this year I said, no, you know what? What are you going to get? One, two, they'll probably be green. It's not worth it. You're taking up all the space. Pull the plants. So I pulled everything. I do have one pepper plant still going because it actually is setting fruit and is growing and is producing. It's a natural late producer. I know that. So I'm keeping that because I'm just being pragmatic about the situation. It has a lot of fruit on it, which it hasn't matured yet, but is maturing. So I'm not being, you know, ruthless. I'm just being pragmatic and smart. So that's like the body. Keep the body because the body doesn't really give what we call the sensation of having age or aging. It doesn't give us that feeling at all. It has an appearance that people say must be associated with this, but the feeling is in the mind. The mind is generating this feeling of aging. It's the mind that's generating this, not the body. Not the body at all. So keep the body. I'm not gonna drop my body. Why should I drop my body? If it's still able to talk and function here, sure. Take them out. Time has no value at all. Aging has no value. So why should we decide who's gonna live the longest? What's the sense of aging? You know, who's gonna have the most intense sense of aging? I've had an intense sense my whole life of being very old. Like 90, I feel like 90. Most of my life I feel like about 95, 90, if 90, you know, just super old. Because this world is thinking, well, they value age. I'm gonna produce this sense of being super old and very aged, and then I'll have value. But then the world said, no, we don't really value that. We value this or this. It keeps shifting and changing what's valued. Now they say, well, now you got to be young to be valued. But then again, who wants to be young, really? Is that really that valuable? It's not. It's not. Who wants to be young and stupid, really? Or just, it's not that it's all cracked up to be there at all. So I would say the feeling of no age. I'm temporarily free of all symptoms of temporality. Temporarily free of temporality. Of course, how could you not be you have to be temporarily free, because temporality is itself temporary. So how could you be permanently free of temporality if temporality itself is impermanent? Right? In reality, there's no question of free or not free of it. It's never been. So we gotta be careful that if we don't say, well, I'm permanently free, because then that's stating that temporality itself is permanent, but just that you're permanently free of it. How can you be permanently free of something that's impermanent, right? So look at it as I'm temporarily free of temporality. Temporarily free of the feeling of temporality. I'm temporarily free of the feeling of temporality. I'm temporarily free of the feeling of temporality. And again, it can't be forced. Don't take drugs to try and force it. They end up making things worse. Because you'll think that somehow it's something that can be grasped directly. And it's not. It's not. Because you will feel that there's some sort of subtlety to be grasped. There's no subtlety to be grasped. As again, I say again, very important, the mental trick that is totally simple, ridiculously simple, stupid, there's no difficulty to it whatsoever. So it's completely obvious. So as long as we're chasing after subtleties, we're going to get farther and farther and farther enmeshed in difficulty. And that's not a good thing at all. It's examining your valuing of it, which is an indirect path, as it were. It's indirect. And it does take a while. That is true. But we, you know, what else is time for except examining your valuing of time? Time is an oscillation between mutual exclusives, thinking that this is producing some third state. Well, the third state it produces is a sense of aging, a sense of time. But is that really a state or just a stupid trick? Produces suffering. And that's all it produces. So you want to call it a third state, fine, but that's all that it produces is suffering. It doesn't produce anything else. Oscillation between mutual exclusives is not the same as abiding in mutual exclusives, both simultaneously. There's no abidance there at all. But we give ourselves medals for saying, well, I've been oscillating between mutual exclusives for 80 years or 20 lifetimes. And people say, wow, that's incredible. You must be really, you know, very, very spiritual. The effects of age on you must have really been amazing. We're told that the effects of age is about time, is supposed to have some effect on us. That's why we worship the ancient buildings, the ancient stuff. Stuff has been there for so long. You think, wow, this place has a sense of time. You know, you go, these places you go to them and you're surrounded by rocks, you know, like the Alabama Hills and the Eastern Sierras, where some of the oldest stones in the world. I went there and spent time in the middle of all these rocks and climbing throughout all of them, you know, camped out there. And trying to see, you know, I'm touching rocks that have been here for 4 billion years or something. All these rocks are like incredibly ancient for some reason. So you think, wow, 4 billion years. I'm standing, I'm sitting, I'm meditating on this rock that's 4 billion years old. I'm surrounded by rocks that are billions and billions of years old. What happened? Nothing happened. Nothing happened. You just decay. I mean, you just look at it, there's nothing. So what? Nothing. It's interesting that Franklin Merrill Wolfe had his house up above the Alabama Hills, overlooking the Owens Valley, the Eastern Sierras, that whole area, Lone Pine and all that, up above the ancient 4 billion year old rocks and stuff up there above it. I don't know what that symbolizes. It's something for sure. I went up to the house. There's nobody there. There's nobody there. Okay. I was gonna knock on the door, but there was nobody. Nobody home. Nobody home. So we people like to surround themselves with you know, these ancient rock formations, these ancient places, these trees, these big trees, you know, the ancient trees, like over in Boulder Creek, California or something. You live among these vast, huge redwoods and stuff. I was actually born in a place where there's these huge, I was born around these huge redwood trees that have been there for thousands of years. That's actually where I was born there. A sense of venerable age, you know, venerable aging. Quickly moved away from there, actually. But the idea that somehow venerableness comes to us with age, you know. So we're seeking the benefits of age. We're seeking some venerable state. You know, maybe we'll be spiritual masters, very venerable. You know. So. And then the idea of giving that all up is like, oh my gosh, I'll have to start all over. You know, that's where the suicide girl comes in and says, oh boy, you know what, you got no life to live. You have to start all over. You lost all your age. You know, you're nothing. You're nothing. The centerless self, what age does it have? Well, there's no center. How can you calculate age? The centerless self is just another term for dropping age. A sense of age. Imagine seeing everything and you see no sense of age whatsoever anywhere. And people say, oh, you're so limited in your scope of, you know, how terrible. What about the richness of time? You look at the redwood trees, you don't see any sense of age there. And you look at, you're missing out on all the venerableness of the planet and something, you know, that's what they'll say. So, there is this incredible propaganda machine going nonstop, which get in the way of a simple decision, you know. So those who know about this need to speak up about it. Jesus said, if you know the truth, you don't speak up about it. He says, that's not good. Not good. So to those who are given, it's necessary that they share it. He says, if you don't share it, it's not a good thing. In the sharing of it, you yourself are also helped. So it's important. It's not something that should be, you know, kept under a Don't hide your light under a bushel, you know, don't hide it. Which is why I make these videos. I could just say nothing about it, but it's so important. It is so important that others hear this and they realize, wow, I'm not alone, that there is this pressure in the world, that we are under this terrible pressure, this marketing. We're marketing to ourselves, really. This goddess marketer, this incredibly seductive marketer that markets to us, is just our own desire to be marketed to, because we want to be different than reality. And if you think, how can we have a new self that's not the same self that God created? Well, through the sense of aging and time is how we're trying to get to it. So we want to be marketed to, so we imagine this very clever marketer who is able to, you know, convince us, at least not totally convince us, but give a convincing song and dance that age is where it's at. We need age. We need some age. And so I'm saying we don't need any sense of age, and that's a hard sell for the world. Now, it is true that when you have no more feeling of age or sense of age, there are some who will keep away from you. Because they say, no, I only want to interact with a sense of age. It makes, I need to feel my age too, right? And you have no sense of age. They say, I can't feel my identity, you know? I don't feel like I have an identity with you. I feel lost. I don't like it. So sure, Jesus said he came to bring a sword, and not bring peace to the world, but a sword of discrimination between the sheep and the goats, of those who wanted a sense of time and age, and those who didn't. And those who didn't found it easy to hang out with Jesus, and those who did said, nah, you know, it's crucifying. I don't like this. This is counter what we want. So of course that not everybody will enjoy your company. Maybe everybody for a little while, but as far as actually, you know what, sense of hanging out, no, not everyone, because they'll feel that they're losing their sense of identity, time-based identity. So this gets us into the next area of do we need this time-based identity, really? And even that question, if we still have too much valuing of the world, it's going to seem very obtuse to us. Won't be able to get to it. Not easily, that is for sure. So with my questioning right now, I say, is there any place I can go in the world that is going to give me a boost? And I say, yeah, probably not. I mean, maybe, you know, not significantly. Any person I can meet, give me a boost, not really. Anything that really can make a difference, and no, and not really. Go down to the desert, drive around, it's nice, that is for sure. It's different, it's nice, but that's only a mild sort of thing. I mean, I'd take it if it was there, but as far as like going to a house, no. Anything that, a place with plants, not really. Go to Hawaii, maybe a minor little boost, you know, but not significant, not enough to really think about. So what do you do? What do you do? Where do you go? What do you do? And so it's urgent to, now people want to change political parties, change agendas, change, hoping it'll give them a boost, because they're saying, everybody feels, wait, I'm not getting enough from this time, from this aging thing, I'm not getting enough. I'm missing something. Well, you know, so let's, something out there is wrong. Give me a better house, give me a better this, give me a better this. I, and all these being marketed to, I want to see a better movie. I want to see something. This aging thing doesn't seem to be working very well for me. I'm kind of concerned. I'm concerned about my identity. It doesn't seem to be really forming in the way that I hoped it would. And I'm getting older, and I'm feeling worse, and the suffering is worse, and aging is worse, I think I'm missing the boat here. What's going on? And so you get pulled into all this external activity of trying to change the world. The change that you need is right in your mind, and it's a simple change. Just drop this stupid little definitional trick. I once asked a young person, very young, who had not yet picked up this aging thing, and then they started doing it. And I said, why are you doing this? And I asked them directly, and they just responded truthfully. I said, because it's fun. It's fun. It's something I want to do, and it's fun. So they literally, I was aware that they literally chose to do so in their mind. No question about it. They made the decision that they wanted to use this little mental trick. It's just a little mental trick, a device we use to feel all of this aging, all of this suffering, all of this stuff is only a simple little mental trick. Nothing more than that. In satsang, like with Punjaji or various Muji, whatever, some people, it's pointed out, and then they see it and say, oh, it's just a simple little mental trick. But that doesn't mean that they abide in it. Not at all. Because they may still value their time and age. So, it can be useful, but that's just the beginning. When you see it, that's just the beginning. I saw it back in 1978. And I said, okay, this is just the beginning. I know I've got a lot of work to do on my valuing of this world. No question about it. And I said, well, that's what my life is for then. That's just what I'll do. And that's what I've done. That is what I've done. I spent my time, whatever it is the Holy Spirit bring my attention to is what I still value this. I value this. I look at it. I'd experience it. I'd do something. And then I'd say, it's really nothing there. It's really not what I thought it was. It's not the answer. No. No more valuing of that. And lessen your valuing. That is how to use your life wisely. So, not everybody that is going to drop aging is attending satsang necessarily, or is real pious and all this stuff. Not necessarily. They may be examining their value of the world, actually, going about that. They may even seem worldly. You don't really know. Because they might just be saying, you know what, I thought being the CEO of a great corporation would give me the sense that I'm, the missing sense that I'm not getting from this aging thing. And it didn't do it. And now I know. Now I know for sure. So I'm not interested. You can make me the CEO of the biggest corporation in the world, whatever. Not interested. Totally not interested. Big yacht. You might see someone on a big yacht. And later on they say, you know, give me the biggest yacht in the world, flotilla of yachts. I'm not interested. This is not it. Forget it. I don't need to sail the seven seas. I don't need to be a big CEO. I don't need to do this and this and this. Forget it. You know, it's a waste of time. All this is a waste of time. And not everybody that's dropped this little mental trick has been some, you know, renunciate beggar or something. No, a lot of times, like kings and queens and you know, high-ranking people, and you know, they're the ones that like realize, like, hey, I've been there, done that. It's nothing. It's nothing. I know I'm never gonna be happy that way. Never. So they say, hey, then they're willing to look at this little mental trick we do. I know people saying, well, what is this mental trick? What is the mental trick? Well, I've pointed it out before in various ways. But again, it's not an academic recognition. It's only important that it be seen in context with actually deciding, okay, let's relax this whole thing. We don't have to get rid of the evidence of previously been engaged in this. The body is evidence that we have been engaged with aging. We don't have to get rid of that. God's not saying, oh, well, you got to get rid of it. Saying, no, just to let and be willing in your mind to you don't need any more aging. You know, you're no longer employing that trick in your mind. That's all that's necessary. The body remains. The redwood trees remain. Everything remains. It's just you no longer see it as having any age-based value. You see everything with ageless, as it were, or without any sense of age. You call it the, I don't want, the terms are flexible on that, but. Everything has full value for you right now. And it's not losing any value and it's not gaining any value. Let's look at it that way. Again, context is more important than the buzzwords. Mantras are helpful. They're a collection of words in such a way that it's very like a drill drilling through it. I'm temporarily free of all symptoms of all temporal symptoms, all symptoms of temporalness, temporality. I'm temporarily free of time. I'm temporarily free of time. I'm temporarily free of time. But context, context, context. I notice a lot of people go to satsang, they go up there and they talk to Muji or whoever, and they, what they're saying is, hey Muji, what is valuable? I need to find something that's valuable. So is this inquiry valuable? You know, they're still trying to find out. You know, they say, so far I feel like what I've done is not giving me the value I'm looking for. And so how can I use time, you know, my aging and age in time, how can I use it to find something that's really valuable? And then you have to point them in the right direction, saying nothing, time has no value. You'll never find it. But you can say, this tree right now has all the value that it'll ever have for me. This bush right now has all the value that it'll ever have for me. It will never have more, it will never have less. So this way you liberate the entire world. Your perception liberates the whole cosmos, actually. See, we are actually cosmic liberators. We liberate the entire cosmos from time. So you experience the true value of everything, or at least the perceptual value right now. Never will have anything more, never have anything less than right now, whatever you're seeing. And it's so again, indirectly, we're going towards this, indirectly. It's definitely there. It is absolutely there. There's no question about it. Simply there. And it's a fabulous opportunity in these days to go for it. Because the other option, now here it was last night, man, there was like a basketball game on and some golf. And I was just checking out the golf. It was up at the top of the channel, 82 or something. And then the basketball was down lower, and so I started clicking the channels, going, usually I just jump from one channel to the other, and that's it. I don't want to, I watch either golf or maybe baseball or basketball, but nothing else on television. And I said, let me just go through the channels. So I went through the channels, channel by channel, and I tell you, what I saw in doing that was so appalling. I went into almost a state of shock. I was just stunned by it, absolutely stunned. I said, are you kidding me? People are actually watching this stuff? Are you kidding me? And I just said, wow, this is just beyond horrible. I don't have any words to put in to describe the terrible content that was on there. So I said, wow, there's nothing there. I can't find happiness there. I can't find it in beautiful homes, beautiful places, beautiful people. Can't find it in movies, can't find it in television, can't find it in politics, can't find it in religion, can't find happiness anywhere. Which sounds like an impressive standpoint. It is. We have to know how to handle the depression, handle the disillusionment, which is to... Now, I made a mistake last week, which is listening to music. Big mistake. I knew it was a mistake, but I was too tempted. I was desperate. I said, keep marketing it to me. I got it. I'm just about ready to let go of age. Give me a little more marketing. So somehow I was guided to listen to some of this music, and it's stuck in my head, and it's been stuck there ever since. Terrible. And it was a very strong way of trying to market the world to me, of time and age, etc. And so we do get cold feet. When we try to do this, we'll get cold feet, and we'll go running back like, how can I market, age and time to myself? Please market it to me. And then you'll find something that's particularly catchy, something that really catches you. And it's been about 4 days now probably, and it's still, it's calming down a little bit, but wow, it was ferocious there for a while. Just the songs keep just, all I heard was the song. Couldn't stop it. Could not stop it. Terrible. So, that's the wrong way to go about it. The right way is to have patience, and it's not easy. I mean, who am I to talk? Because I lose my patience sometimes too, but it's good to have it every day, to have a time where you simply do nothing. Almost nothing. You're not listening to music, you're not watching anything, or even this video, probably. You're just quiet with your own inner process. And just aware, just looking and aware of your inner process. Whatever it is, just look at it. Just look at it. Get familiar with it. The more familiar you are with your inner process, the easier it becomes, actually. And, when you're tired at the end of the day of work, you're just exhausted. I was just so tired. All I want to do is just listen to some music or something. But bam, boy, did I pay a severe price. And I have many times. I always tell myself, don't start listening to music that is going to really slam you for days and days afterwards. And it always does. Pay a terrible price. Same thing with drugs. People will light up a pipe, at the end of the day, they say, I just need to relax and just get a break from this. But then that has lingering effects the next day, and the next day you feel out of sync. You just can't quite connect with your inner process because you're still dealing with the distorted, altered, processes that the drug produced. And so it actually ends up, setting you back. And you don't want to get set back right now. No way. Just stay solemn. Maybe stay solemn, quiet, humble, meek, solemn. And keep checking in with your inner processes. And trust your own organic process. That's another thing. I was also going out looking at other teachers, or teacher ways, all looking, trying to say, hey, can I find something? And that just actually messed things up for me. Pay attention to your own organic process. The way that you use words, keep using the way you use them. Keep doing things the way you're doing them. It's your process. It's an organic process for you. Just for you. For nobody else. And just keep following that. Keep going along with it. And if you get a sense of reassurance, that's good. If you can get some reassurance, that's very helpful. That's what I look for. Sometimes I'm looking, just can I get any reassurance from the world? And no, I can't find it. I really cannot find it. It's very difficult to find. And even then, the terminology is all completely different and very different. And I could feel like guilty, like, hey, I'm not doing it the way they're doing it. There's something wrong with me. No. Your own process is what's important. Stick with that process. So I don't know how it's going to go. What I do is I just report this, you know, my own process, externalize it so people can realize there is a process. You can go through it. It's your own process, but it most definitely, it's dealing with the same basic stuff for sure. Absolutely for sure. Different words can be used, different approaches, yeah, but it's the same basic ballpark of this sense, this mental trick. It's the same mental trick for all time, for everybody. Same little silly thing we do, which gives us this feeling of time, a sense of time. It's all in our mind, a trick of just definition, really. I once woke up from a dream. I was having this dream of what was it? I was in a sort of a half awake state. I slipped just momentarily, and I dreamed this vast dream of ages is so much. And then I woke up again, and then I realized, wait a minute, I was only asleep for just a couple seconds or something. I just dozed off just momentarily. I caught it, and I said, and just in that moment, I had this vast sense of time. I said, how is that possible? How is that possible? It is our mind that generates a sense of time. And our mind can generate a sense of a trillion years this instant. But as soon as you do that mental trick, then you think you're in this trillion years of time as an identity needing to then work your way through this time to the end of it. But the end is at the beginning. The beginning and the end are one. It is one little trick. So when you see that, a trillion years can vanish instantly. There's no more trillion years. So you don't have to work your way through a trillion years at all. Gone. If you value, you know, working your way through a trillion years, thinking that if you have trillion years to work on something, you're going to be incredibly venerable, then you're not going to see the trick. You're not going to see it. Because if you see it, you'll realize trillion years is nothing. It's happening right now. It's just a trick of the mind. It's not really there at all. So, these times are intense for sure. And so everybody, if you're feeling some intensity, you're join the club, really. I'd say that's a good club to be in right now. It's a very good time to drop time. Let's put it that way.